So it's been an entire week and I have so much to tell you. Lots of things have happened in this week. I started lectures, I met with my supervisors, I explored a bit, I went clubbing for the first time in Cambridge. So many new experiences and so many new things that I've learned. To start where we left off on day two, we finally got the chance to eat a full English breakfast. We went to Fitzbillies, which is very close to Pembroke, and it's actually known to be one of like the tourist spots just because it's a bit more expensive.
What do you guys think of the tea?
It has like a depth to it. I like tea. I like drink a lot of tea when I'm back home. I think so.
Okay, so that makes me more confident that this is.
Oh, it definitely has a discoloration, so yeah. I think you're right.
I tried the Chelsea bun and I thought it was good. I think that I'm not super used to the raisins being on it, but it's good. And the full English breakfast was delicious. I went with Shirin and Madison and we had a good time. To be fair, this is before we had tried Pembroke's brunch. The server is essentially our dining hall, like where we get our food, the cafeteria, but they call the place you get food trough, and where you sit, like the three long tables, think Harry Potter, they call it hall. Pembroke only offers brunch on the weekends, and so we were only able to try it on Saturday. And let me tell you, the food was delicious. Some of the other semester students had other opinions, but I think it's because I'm just not a picky eater and I love eggs, I love breakfast foods in general. I had a good time. Right now, Pembroke's not accepting guests, but I was told by people from other colleges to let them know as soon as Pembroke opens up their brunch to guests again because it's apparently very coveted. And let me tell you, something about Trough's sausages in any capacity, those sausages have crack in it. They are so good. They're so juicy. I don't know how to explain it other than that. Maybe it's because we've only been here a week and we'll get tired of it soon, but that's my current review. Now that I have a bike, it's so much easier to get places, and I recommend any semester abroad students at Cambridge to get a bike immediately. It is so convenient and it cuts down a walking time of like maybe 15 to 20 minutes to like 5 to 6.
Guys, I finally got a bike. I'm about to bike back. I also spent the entire Uber ride on the way to the Facebook Marketplace person's house to pick up the bike. I spent the entire ride speaking in a British accent and he didn't ask where I was from. I feel like my accent's getting a little bit better.
If you send me the location, then I'll be right there.
It's also important to get a good bike lock here because people will take them. I also tried rowing for the first time. We went to the Pembroke Boat Club. They have this boathouse on the water and it's really beautiful. We walked in, I took a lot of videos, and we tried rowing. We were out on the water for 40 minutes learning all these different commands. I was on the bow side. I was also number 7, if that means anything to you.
Your boyfriend's on a waiting thing, looking for one wish on a Ray J thing. I prayed that girl, outrageous thing, but she can't see cause I got shades in.
Something really fun that my friend Bailey and I did was we went around sneaking into the other colleges. So right now a lot of them aren't taking visitors and most of them are actually closed off to anyone, even if they have a cam card the way we do. We visited King's College, which is so large. It's the one that you see on most postcards, and there are just a lot of tourists there. I don't know how I would feel as a King's College student waking up every day, walking around campus, and just seeing a ton of tourists taking pictures, but King's College was majestic. I don't know if there are any other words to describe it. They have this gigantic chapel that we went in, and I think we're planning on going to one of the chapel services. It was truly beautiful. It transported me back into time, and the church is dedicated to the Virgin Mary, and the stained glass depicts her life from her conception all the way to her going up to heaven, and I thought that was very beautiful. There's a lot of history as well in there, and you can read about all the kings that were benefactors in the past, kings that left plans for the chapel to be built after they passed away. My friends and I always talk about how walking around Cambridge feels like a set. It doesn't really feel real because everything is so different, but that chapel itself is a different kind of set. we felt like we were back in like the 1500s, and that was just the kind of world we lived in. I also grew up in choir, and my choir director always showed us videos of the choir that sings in King's Chapel every day, and that's something that I really want to see live, so hopefully we get that experience before we leave. During our Pembroke tour, we were told that a lot of students here feel kind of isolated from the outside world. And they say that about Columbia too, that it's a bubble and that you kind of forget what's going on outside, but typically in a negative way. They say that in terms of academic stress, the bubble starts to make you feel really closed in. Here, I feel like being isolated is almost a positive thing because you get to immerse yourself into old academia, think those vibes like churches, old buildings, Gothic architecture, and the community is very small as well.
This is very beautiful. So we have King's College behind us. This is Claire, and that is Trinity, or so you say.
It is Trinity, I think.
Okay, so we're walking back to the dorm and we have our robes. We explored the colleges and illegally, by the way.
And we got away with it.
Honestly, we got kind of a rush out of it. It was a good time. Now we're heading back before the sun sets, even though it's literally 3:30. Because it seems like there's a lot of people out right now, but as soon as the sun sets, everyone disappears.
The bookstore here, Ryder and Amy's, is actually gonna take all of my money because I bought a puffer jacket. It's kind of iconic here because each college has their own, and you can see here that mine is Pembroke. We have our own crest. It's on the left. And then also on the right, I got my initials. And the thing is, having grown up in Texas where everyone had monogrammed things in middle school, but now it's like really cringy, you can't do it ever. I was so against the initials at first, but first of all, I'm a sheep, so after seeing like 100 other people wear it, I was like, okay, I need to have it. And second of all, the convincing factor for me was that it's hard to steal because it has your initials on it, you know? Like, if, like, you wouldn't pick up a jacket with someone else's initials on it and then like try and pass it off as your own. The second thing that I got from Ryder and Amy's is actually mandatory. It's our robes, our Pembroke College robes, and the Brits here hate it when you compare them to Harry Potter because Harry Potter actually came from them and was influenced by the Oxford and Cambridge old academia vibes, but the robes really do make me feel like I just came out of Harry Potter. We wear them for matriculation, which is on Thursday, and for formal halls. Back in the States, a formal is like a dance or like a sorority fraternity function at the end of the semester, and here formal halls are like 3 times a week and they're just like fancy, fancy dinners. You're only limited to bring one bottle of wine, and if your friends are particularly mean that day, they might peer pressure you into doing a shoe, which is when you fill your shoe, you take off your shoe, you fill it up with wine, and you drink it in front of everyone. You chug it. It sounds very disgusting to any American, but it's just a tradition there. About the social scene. So the clubs here are so, so, so different than they are in the States. I think it's because the drinking age is 18. But there's no concept of promoters, at least not in the Cambridge clubs. So far, we've only been out to clubs twice. We went to Rumboogie Night on Wednesdays at Revolution, which they call Revs. The music was really interesting, so we didn't get tickets beforehand, which meant we had to line up early at 10 p.m. to get tickets at the door. And it was very early. I will say the place was empty when we came in. They have a coat check. They call it a cloak room. I tried a WKD for the first time, which is a blue drink. It's equivalent to like a Smirnoff Ice in the States. And then also they had a deal on Jaeger bombs. I think the music got better as the night went on, but in the beginning we were all so confused. It was remixes of Ed Sheeran, Adele, Hozier. It was very singable music, which I love because I'm a singer, but I don't know if it was fit for a club kind of night. It's also different because here you have to buy tickets to get into clubs. They're typically not much. It's like £3 to £5. And in the States, there isn't really a ticket situation unless it's a ticketed event with like a famous rapper or a DJ or something there. But I think you could compare it to like a cover in the United States, like a $20 cover or something. It seems cheap here, but I'm sure it adds up if you go clubbing a lot. Like those £5 are gonna start turning into £20 and then like £40. We also went to MASH on Friday and we collectively agreed that the music at MASH is a bit better. They did play British rap, which none of us understand. Back at Columbia, we have a lot of late night drunk food places such as Cornette's. That's our main one. Greasy, large slices of pizza. But here everything closes early. And I think the only late night food place you can go to is McDonald's, which actually closes at like 3. So if you're out past then, probably just eat air. I don't know. And then also I think they have a truck that comes into Market Square, which is kind of in the center of all the clubs.
Hi guys, we're at the club. I don't know how it works, but we're in the line.
Unexpected thing for me to experience this week was how tired I get at night. And not even like at night like 9, 10, but like 6, 7, I start to get so drowsy. A lot of us just, you know, we conk out. I think it's because the sun sets at 4 and people don't go out until like 10, 11, unless you go hit pubs first and then it might be a little bit earlier. You have this miscellaneous like 3 to 4 hour gap between dinner and going out that truly hits like a whole bottle of melatonin. By the way, they don't sell melatonin here over the counter. So that's really interesting. I think you might need a prescription. I don't know if it's just me getting older, can't really rally as much, but I don't believe that. I really don't believe that. And I know it's hitting other people too. I'm not sure if it's jet lag. Maybe it's a combination of jet lag and also not a lot of things happening. Here their weeks start on Thursday. And I think it's just a Cambridge thing. Our equivalent of a Monday, you know, people are like, oh, look, Monday, you know, dreading it, first day of the week. For here, that's Thursday. And so the whole concept of like having a weekend and stuff is just flipped upside down. The students here take a lot of classes. And what I've heard is that honestly, most of them just study all the time. So maybe it's like a 7-day week. And you just have certain nights that you go out on, for example, Rumboogie at Rev's on Wednesday, MASH on Fridays, Lola Lows on Sundays. Anyway, just a lot of different things that we're adjusting to. Another really unexpected thing was that Pembroke specifically, and I think other colleges have different ballots and lotteries for housing, but Pembroke specifically has a scholars ballot, which is when you come in like first or second in the class, you get ranked on your exams. You get put into a lottery for better housing in college. I wish we lived in college because we live like 15 minutes away and it's actually a huge trek, but living in college must seem otherworldly, honestly, because you are in the center of everything. The food's right there. You don't have to walk that far. I thought that was really interesting because we don't have that kind of system in the States. A lot of schools are actually abolishing rank and GPA and valedictorian, salutatorian, things like that. So I wonder what contributes to that. I know another college has a system in which the ballot is not only academics, but how many societies you're involved in, which is equivalent to clubs and organizations in the States. And that starts to get a bit problematic because the people that have more time to be involved in societies are arts majors rather than STEM majors. Anyway, that's my recap for the week. I'm sure there's so much more that I will have to get back to you on, but for now, I hope you enjoyed, and I will see you later. Party, free Somalis, creeping on me, your ex-wavy, we tsunami.